when it comes to technology as one part of the commercials, how do you think that is going to impact cycling? I mean, the two technology or the two apps that I can think of are Strava and Zwift, which I saw everybody reposting to their Instagram handles. So those are the two that come to my mind. Does that play a role in sort of boosting cycling or gamifying the experience to encourage more people to come in? What's your take on that?
Yeah, so I was part of that initial kind of, what do you call it when a hashtag rises to the top?
Virality? Being viral?
Yeah, virality of it. Yeah. And that was like a month into the pandemic. I think apps like Zwift and Strava saw peak participation levels, you know.
Yeah.
And this is globally, we're talking for Zwift around 25 or 30,000, which is, if you really look at it, it's not massive when you compare it to some other sports. But at the same time, it really kind of showed what the potential of virtual cycling is. Strava has always been around, but a lot of people got a lot more time to pursue whatever their sport was, whether it was running or cycling. In India, the uptake of technologies like Zwift has been hindered a little bit because of the lack of availability of equipment, because the platform, it requires, again, an investment. You know, it literally the cost of entry to Zwift is not just the $20 monthly membership. It's a lakh and a half in terms of equipment. You need a smart trainer to get you onto that platform, right? So it's like buying an Xbox, except it's your bike on a platform, right? That allows you to play. So there's this not upfront cost, and that isn't coming down at any point. You know, that's staying there because there isn't a lot of competition in that space globally, and so the Zwift kind of, you know, the virtual cycling space, which has a couple of competitors to Zwift, it's going to see a lot of growth outside India. But in India, just that, again, that barrier to entry is that cost of equipment. And yeah, during the pandemic, I'm sponsored by one of those people who make trainers, and they were just out of stock. And India doesn't keep huge stock of these things, you know. There's about 20 for a country of, you know.
Oh, wow.
20 or 30 is the order numbers, whereas the cycling community in Bangalore is about 5,000, right? So there's definitely a huge gap there in terms of the supply and demand. So, the cost of entry is also a huge one. So as to whether virtual cycling is going to take kind of root in India, it makes a lot of sense because large parts of India, you know, in the monsoons, it's hard to ride outside. Pollution, traffic makes it really hard for people living in tier one cities to get outside and enjoy their sport. And virtual cycling does offer the perfect solution, but it's almost a chasm. It's not a gap, you know, in terms of that availability and that price to get in. So it's not something that's going to see exponential growth. It's something that maybe over the course of, you know, again, half a decade types might see growth, but it's not something that, for example, February to March in the UK saw, numbers go from 5,000 to 15,000. That's even not exponential. But in India, it's probably about, you know, it was probably about 50 to about 200, you know, so much smaller numbers. And I think that's kind of what's going to continue there. It's not going to be explosive growth. But yeah, that's where kind of virtual cycling lies as far as Indian cycling goes.